On 60 Minutes, they never thought it could happen.
You're like a baby.
A story of courage.
What can you offer her?
A friend?
Our young people fighting back from strokes.
I was only 13, so I proved them all wrong.
Also, the crime-fighting revolution sweeping Australia. Hidden cameras that watch your every move. Plus, Mr. Nice Guy.
I'm in love with my wife. I've got 4 kids.
The secret of Steve Vizard's success.
Stupidity and obsessiveness.
Toyota presents 60 Minutes, 7:30 Sunday.
I'm gonna use a new vacuum cleaner, Mum, okay?
With more features, more power, and more to make life easier, everyone wants a turn of the new Electrolux Excelio, the ultimate vacuum cleaner.
Might even get rid of the smell.
Tonight, following sale of the century, Superman loses control of his powers in Lois and Clark. That's followed by ER, 9:30 The Footy Show Live. This program proudly brought to you by Spam, real spiced ham.
Early morning, Darling Harbour, slowly building to be one of the vibey places in Sydney. And we're going to find vibe, and people are going to find this guy. Neil Perry, welcome back to the show.
All right, pleasure to be here.
Another venture.
Yeah, just had to do it. Got overexcited.
Oh, did you? Caught yourself at a weak moment.
I did. I came and sat and looked at this view and thought, I'm just going to be here. And so we've ended up here. Yeah, it's great. We're putting some fantastic fish through the place.
Mm-hmm.
And people are really starting to come to Darling Harbour to eat for, you know, one of the first times, really.
That's right. Darling Harbour's always been like a bit of a playground. There's things for the kids, there's a vibe and a feel.
Yep.
But now food's starting to creep in here at a good level.
Yeah, I think so. I think as it develops, there's other things happening within the whole complex that are going to make sure that, you know, everyone's catered for. There's good food and there's simple food and there's lots of play, as you say, which is great.
Which is good. So tell me, describe the Star Grill in terms of its vibe and its menu.
I think it's sort of like a really buzzy place, obviously great outdoors.
Mm-hmm.
We have an oyster and crustacean bar that people can sit around and eat fresh gear all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And the main thrust is seafood,
mm-hmm.
Really, really well-aged beefs and things on the rotisserie,
mm-hmm.
and a slight Middle Eastern, sort of Mediterranean kind of flavours.
Bit of everything. You seem to have your hand in every sort of cuisine, which I
haven't. Yeah, I can't help myself, really. Yeah.
Is there any cuisine you haven't sort of ventured into that you think is the next frontier for you?
I don't know. I think I'm pretty much where I like to be, which is pretty heavily entrenched in Asian food.
Yeah.
And then really looking at Middle East and Mediterranean, which again is a great passion of mine.
Neil, Sydney food has evolved over the years and it's taken on some different feels and you've always been at the front of it. Is there a Sydney food, a cuisine that's identified?
Well, I don't think you can put your finger on it exactly, but I think it is really sort of, you know, it's produce driven, it's fresh produce, it's a really nice fresh approach by the cooks.
Mm-hmm.
And those guys cook in very different fashions, but somehow there's something about that flavour that says Sydney. It's a vibrance, you know?
Yeah, I think so too. Yeah. I tend to agree. Tell me about the produce. Is it going to keep coming in its great style and standard, or is there any threat to the produce in Australia?
Well, I think we're going to have to fight for it. I mean, I'm finding at the moment that we're really having to start our own fish program so that we can get fish of export quality straight off the boats and into the back of the restaurant and, you know, of course, on the plate, which is what we want to do. But, you know, that's an expensive undertaking, and it's also, yeah, there's a lot of extra pressure on us because we're now going to the realms of sort of, you know, fish wholesaler, only to our own group, but we're taking that extra step.
So you're saying that a lot of Australia's great produce is just being picked up and sort of shipped overseas where people know how to handle it?
Where people know how to handle it and how to respect it. You know, fishermen are looking after the fish. Mm-hmm. They need to know that they can get a better price and, and that product can be respected. And when you see Ikejima spike eye, slurry blue eye, you'll never worry about trawl blue eye again.
Okay, fair enough. So to maintain that quality, it's got to filter all the way down the whole system. So the fishermen have to handle it well, you guys know have to know how to
exactly.
do it.
Exactly.
And the customer
has to appreciate it on the plate.
And has to pay for it too.
Well, exactly. And I think, you know, we're really in a situation in Australia and Sydney where we've got some of the best, cheapest food in the world, and that goes from, you know, cafes right through to the best restaurants. And I think we're still going to maintain good value, but of course prices are going to have to go up because the push is on, we're under the pump, and everyone's trying to grab our produce. We want to export because, you know, it's all part of the economy living and thriving.
It is amazing because it never ceases to astound me how typically in Australia we will sit at a restaurant at the end of the meal, so it was a great meal, but gee, it cost us $100 a head.
Yeah.
What do you pay for a great meal in France?
Well, you get scared, I think, when you see the bill over there, but I mean, yeah. I've eaten restaurants without having a huge drink and spent sort of $500 a cover quite easily. So
that's France. You know, what about Japan?
Oh, mate, you're probably talking about $1,000 a cover for a good restaurant. You'd have to be invited to it. You know, that's how good they are over there. But
New York?
Yeah, again, you know, you're paying in American dollars by the time they add tax on and everything. You get your Amex bill and you get back and, you know, you're paying 50% more than you are in Sydney for the best restaurants. And I think the great thing about Sydney restaurants is you know, the ones that really look after it, the underlying quality of that produce is just spanking, you know, it's fantastic.
It is outstanding. We've got to protect that. It's a national treasure.
It is our treasure.
It really is.
Yeah.
Okay, this book, at last, long time coming.
Yeah, long time.
So who twisted your arm?
Oh, lots of friends. Lots of great cooks like Steve Manfredi and David Thompson said, you've got to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Met Sue Hines from Reed Books, and she talked me into it, and it was great. It was fun, actually. It was kind of discovering yourself.
Yep.
Thinking about what your life had been up to date, what had made you do, the things that you'd done. And I guess that's kind of Rockpool, 1996, and we're moving on. We're growing again.
Good. You know? I like the way you describe it, too. You distilled your experiences. Okay, now, just flicking through the book, wine, of course, you cover.
Yeah. Very important to us. Yeah.
Now, Eastern cooking, that's quite a large section. How important is Eastern cooking to Australia's style?
Well, I think it's got to be a major influence. I mean, you're looking at... with France and Italy, and then to my mind, after that, you've got, you know, Thai and Chinese as being major influences, and all those things are going to end up being the Australian styles. You know, how can you go to the market and see wonderful fresh, you know, coriander and Chinese vegetables not integrated into cooking? You cannot do it, you know.
Well, there you go, and the book moves on to talk about Western influences, of course, pastas, doughs, pizzas, all of that, it's all covered.
Yeah, it's all in it because it's all part of my cooking. We make fresh noodles, Italian style, and we use an Asian broth with it. I mean, that's just
beautiful.
Us. That's our way.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Okay, now the book, is it going overseas?
Well, at the moment, bookshops are buying it in New York and London, but as yet, we haven't got a publisher overseas yet.
And is Neil Perry going overseas?
Oh, we might have a little Rockpool outlet at some stage if I get enough time in my day. I mean, my wife's not quite sure what time I'd have to get up in the morning, but she reckons it's early enough at the moment. Her and Josephine are usually in bed when I leave and when I get home. So
it's a big call. You're a busy man, but seriously, are we going to lose you? Are we going to lose our major talents? We lose our sporting identities to overseas because that's the market that they can really thrive in and go forward. And what about our
well, Geoff?
People?
I mean, I don't know about the rest of them, but I love Sydney so much and I love Australia so much that if I went overseas, it would be just a train people open a rock pool, drop in a few times a year. Wave that Australian flag as hard.
Kiss a few babies.
Wave that Australian flag as hard as I could. And hopefully for the great guys who work for me, give some opportunities to them. But you'd be hard pressed to get me out of the country for the majority of my life. That's the rest of my life, that's for sure.
Good to hear. Well, Neil, thanks for spending your time with us.
Pleasure.
Spamburger hamburger. This is a Spamburger.
You just cut it like this.
Just cut it like this. Easy.
Oh, I see. If you cut it this way, it makes 3/4-pound burgers.
Now that's a good deal.
Slice regular Spam or Spam Light, and you've got the Spam Burger. It's one great-tasting hamburger.
Have you seen my blockout security shutters?
No. Let's have a closer look. That's not a genuine blockout.
Aren't they all the same?
No, and I'll show you why.
I can't make these budge.
That's because of Blockout's exclusive Maxi Block system, which gives me extra security and keeps the house cool. Don't settle for second best. Phone Blockout direct or find us under Blockout in the white pages.
Get tough, get Blockout tough.
To make Dolmio's chunky bolognese sauce, we start with the freshest vegetables. Chop to get a chunky sauce unlike any other, then blended with herbs and spices to give you a true Italian flavor.
That's a delicious, Mama. And chunky.
Dolmio Chunky Bolognese Sauce. We put the good things in, so you'll wear the Dolmio grin.
Nick Scali Furniture Chatswood's grand opening sale starts Saturday with huge reductions on the North Shore's largest range of Italian furniture. Leather lounges, dining and bedrooms, all reduced at Nick Scali Chatswood's grand opening sale, 575 Pacific Highway, Chatswood.
Yo, the McDonald's to a D.
They're delectable. They're delicious.
New Fish McDeluxe. The deliciousness of ripe tomatoes, fresh lettuce, cheese, atop a fillet of fish and tartare sauce.
8:30 tonight.
Oh, I love that.
Emotional times on ER.
She's leaving.
You having second thoughts?
She's made her decision.
Of course I'm having second thoughts.
I don't see any point in saying anything.
But time is running out.
What's the matter with you guys, the wimps? They're all petrified to make a move.
The decision of a lifetime.
Mark is acting so odd.
Say to her what you've been wanting to say for years. You tell her how you feel.
An episode you won't want to miss.
We do have a chaplain here in the hospital if we're serious.
Optus presents ER.
They're calling for us from the ER.
What is it?
A wedding.
Tonight on 9.
Here is a Vietnamese-inspired peanut-crusted beef salad. A good little idea, and I'll show you how to make it. The music's still going. That's the peanut-crusted beef salad music. Top 40. Very good song. Here we go. Now, what we want to do is we want to marinate the actual beef and just have a look at my rump. Isn't it fantastic? 600 grams of it. Now, we're having a bit of a rump joke earlier on, but, you know, a lot of the guys reckon that they prefer the rump steak, full-flavoured. You don't have to, have all the fat on the outside. You can trim that off. But anyway, the rump is there, nice little piece, and we'll add to that about 2 cloves of garlic. Yum! And the equivalent amount of ginger. Now, I have this sort of wooden ginger grater. By the way, see these wooden ginger graters? I found some at the fish markets. There's a little guy that sort of sells all sort of knickknacks, and they sell them at the fish markets in Sydney, this was, and also there's ceramic ginger grater. So go there, buy them. They're not expensive, and they really do the job. Probably available in other places too, but there's a little tip off of the Sydney ciders. So scrape the ginger away on these graters and give it a bit of a knock around. That's why I like them. They're so handy, and you can just bash them around to get everything out. I love that. We're going to use a tablespoon of oil in the total recipe, but I'll add half of it here, along with about 1/4 cup of fish sauce. Okay, generous amount. Look at this. This Thai fish sauce, available just about everywhere. Get it in Bangkok, get it everywhere. But this is a good brand, look out for that one. It has a strong flavor, good fishy flavor, and it certainly is to be used in cooking when you're putting these Vietnamese concepts together. Now really, toss this around, you know, swizzle around, get all the flavour into it. And after at least 2 or 3 hours in the fridge, preferably overnight, you have a well-marinated piece of rump steak like that, okay? Ready to go. Let's just leave that there for the moment and move on to our salad. Now, the way we're doing the salad is, again, typically Vietnamese. Let's take the red onion. Slice it straight down the centre. And then what we want to do is cut this into like little wedges. Two ways of doing it. If you're really pedantic, you'll come in at a slight angle like that and sort of work your way up so you go nice and straight. Now, that gives you a very fine result. But if you've got about 1,000 onions to do, all you do is just cut straight down like that. So, in other words, it takes a while to go at an angle. Just go straight down, nice and thin. Okay, there's the onion, nice and finely sliced. Tip that into a bowl, along with, you need thin pieces of carrot. Now, the best way to do the carrot, in my view, is to use one of these peelers. You know what, at the fish markets, at the same place, same little bloke, he's got these peelers, right? The ones I like, you know, why don't we ever have them here? I'm going to hit Phil. The asparagus peelers, right? Have you seen those? They're good, they're horseshoe shaped, and you just do the peels like that. Fantastic job. I'll use this one anyway, Phil. And just, well, this one's not too bad either. Anyway, Go and get these and just do that. It's a great thing to do. The whole carrot till you've got nice little slices like that. And the other thing is a cucumber. One of those Lebanese cucumbers. By the way, with your cukes, have a look here. If I cut the tip off there, the seeds aren't visible just there, right? Therefore, that end's likely to be bitter. Keep going. Ah, no seeds. It's probably still bitter. Still bitter. Bitter on the foot. Starting to see some seeds? There, some seeds. So I suggest that you always cut off the end bits until you get to the seed part, and that's where you're sure not to get any bitterness. And basically, cut it in half, and then probably at an angle, just little slices of cucumber. Essentially, do all of that. You can take some of the seeds out if you wish, but you don't really need to. Hey, it's cucumber. So put that in the bowl. We've done some earlier, and this is the good thing. It's just a simple, simple vinegar that we add to it. Imagine it's all in this little bowl up here, a quarter of a cup of vinegar, right, just splashed in. Cucumbers, the rest of the carrot would have been there. Just toss it from time to time and let it sit. All the vinegar does is just make it sour. Now, it just sort of gives it a bit of sharpness to the whole dish. In the meantime, we want to do a rough coating with the peanuts. 125 grams of crushed toasted peanuts in here, to which we're going to add about 2 teaspoons of dry curry powder. This is a Malaysian style one. And you have 2 to 4 teaspoons of cracked black pepper, freshly cracked. We have about a tablespoon of flour. Mix it through. Okay, what you really want to do is to make sure that the peanuts themselves are coated with all those various ingredients, because it's the peanuts what are going to stick to our steak. Okay, that's well mixed. Now, with the steak, we want to scrape off some of that ginger and garlic on the outside so that the steak will actually stick to the peanuts and vice versa. There we go. Oh, silly thing. Get back. And there, done, ready to go. Into our peanuts. And time for a good solid pressing. Okay. So one side. Turn it over. Look at that. You have to be nuts not to like this. It's a great little dish. Now the thing is, when you're frying peanuts, you've got to be careful. They can burn quite easily. So the recommended method here is to take the rest of the oil that we didn't use, which is about 1 tablespoon, lubricate your pan quite well, shake off the excess peanuts and mixture, right, and gently fry it in that, right, it's frying away nicely. Just to seal that on the surface, give it about 30 seconds, that's right, and turn it over. And do about 30 seconds on that side, then take it out and pop it into the oven and finish it off at a low temperature in the oven, about 5 minutes or so, and that will give you a nice even cooking. Let it rest for another 5 minutes or so, slice it across the grain, out with the salad ingredients, steak over the top, and there it is, peanut crusted beef salad.
Batter up.
Welcome to Big Leagues, Hayseed.
Those major leaguers are back and sillier than ever.
Did you ever have that feeling you were just born for greatness?
For the first time, Charlie Sheen, Tom Berenger, Corbin Burnson, Rene Russo. Major League 2, Sunday on 9.
I found this Thai recipe for lamb. Hope it doesn't make you homesick.
So, which city were you born in, Tok?
Ballarat, actually.
Ballarat? Well, there you go. Ballarat satay lamb.
Lamb, the multicultural meal.
Make a Mexican meal in minutes with Old El Paso burritos.
Old El Paso, Old El Paso.
These super specials at Sleep City. Futon sofa beds now a crazy $299. Queen size package deals including bed, mattress and linen from a low $549. Take 10% off our discount prices on all timber beds and bedroom furniture. Save up to $500 off. Pay only $10 deposit and get 10 months interest free. Yes, 10% off, $10 deposit and 10 months interest free. So hurry to a Sleep City store near you.
Sleep City, Sleep City.
each kernel of corn is ripened by 120 days of sunshine. Or it could be all those crunchy golden flakes drenched in ice-cold milk. But surely, it's the simple, refreshing taste that makes so many Australians start their day with Kellogg's Corn Flakes.
It's March Magic at Retrovision. We're giving away $25,000 in cash, and you can share in it when you buy a big brand washing machine or dryer from Retrovision right now. Fisher & Paykel, Simpson, Samsung, Sanyo, Hoover, Whirlpool. $25,000 in cash to be won. Get into March Magic.
The Tilecraft birthday celebration is now on. Ceramic wall and floor tiles, only $15.95. Beautiful Italian terracotta, only $19.95. So hurry, join the birthday celebrations at Tilecraft before the party ends.
Oh, sorry, I'm late. Are your parents here?
They're at the table already. Here, take this.
What's this?
Lamb souvlaki.
Lamb souvlaki? Where did you learn to make lamb? Souvlaki.
Lamb, the multicultural meal.
Chanel.
Hello.
Upside down peach and hazelnut cake.
It is, yes.
Where do you get upside down peaches? China.
No, from the kitchen out the back.
Really? Yes. They are upside down at the moment. Oh, I don't know what's got into
They're
them.
They're good though, aren't they?
Yeah, I think it's Julie winning the bronze medal in the canoeing.
Isn't she clever?
Absolutely clever. Single, but clever. She beat her boyfriend. Not good.
I know, it's not a good thing to do, yes. Is it? Now, in here,
yeah,
we've got 60 grams of melted butter.
Really?
Okay. And about a third of a cup of brown sugar.
Okay.
That just goes back into the microwave oven,
mm-hmm,
to dissolve the brown sugar just for a few seconds, about 20 or 30 seconds.
Right, 27.
And then we're going to pour that into the base. And while we're doing that, maybe you can slice the peaches.
Oh.
No?
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so we've got either one large peach or two medium peaches.
Can I just say, has Phil been cruel and given me one of those cling stones, or is it a slip stone?
Oh, you'll soon find out.
It's a slip stone, Phil. Phil's there watching.
You'll soon find out. Now, I don't take the skin off for this recipe. I figure that if you're going to make a 12-minute microwave cake, you're not going to spend 20 minutes taking the skin off.
No.
The peach. And it actually helps with the colour as well in the presentation. So just stir this base mixture together.
Stirred, not shaken?
No, just stir.
Stirred.
And then this goes into the base. And here we've got a 23 centimetre. This one's a plastic cake dish.
Yuck, you'll die.
No, you won't.
Don't use plastics in microwaves.
Yes,
you told me that.
Microwave safe plastic. It says on the bottom.
Okay.
Okay, so we just spread that around the base. If you've got more time at home, just take a little bit more time to make it even.
Yes.
Okay, and then the peaches go around decoratively. Okay,
yes,
perfectly.
It's better than that.
Don't fear it. And then in here we've got 100 grams of softened butter.
Right.
To half a cup.
This is a good thing, boys and girls. We had melted butter here, which is exactly what we needed.
Mm-hmm.
And softened butter there. Now the melted butter wouldn't work there. It'd be too oily. It'd separate.
That's right. Now, a couple of tips with butter in the microwave. When you're melting it, melt it on medium high rather than on high, because it doesn't separate. The two layers won't separate as much when you're using medium high power.
Oh, I see.
Okay, and to soften your butter in the microwave when you're making a cake, it's best to chop it up into cubes.
Yes.
And soften it on defrost. In 1 minute bursts.
Soften it on defrost?
Yes.
Okay.
Because that way you're not going to melt the butter. So we add, well, you're quick. One egg at a time, if you can crack the other egg.
Yes.
Okay, so two eggs. They go in one at a time.
Let me.
Oh, thank you. And a little bit of vanilla.
I'll do that too.
Yes? Okay. Oh, you're very helpful today.
I'm a lovely boy. Now, how much do you want to
give?
So
just half a teaspoon.
Half a teaspoon?
Yep, good.
Wow.
Okay. So that goes in there just until it's well combined. You don't want to aerate this too much. It's a little different to making a cake conventionally. If you aerate it too much, you'll get air bubbles in the cake.
Oh,
and you find that that's when they tend to dry out in the microwave oven.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
So the more air in the cake, the more it dries out.
That's right.
Okay. Mm.
So we just whisk it till it's well combined. And then we add all the other ingredients. We've got a third of a cup of toasted hazelnuts that have been chopped. And you can, it depends on the consistency that you want. You can either grind them right down or roughly chop them like we've done. We have to sift this.
Yeah, I was going to do that.
The self-raising flour, a third of a cup of cocoa, and I think it's 1 1/4 cups of self-raising flour.
Mm.
Now, this goes in with around about 1 1/4 cup of peach nectar, because we're using peaches.
Oh,
but
yeah.
If you can't get peach nectar, sometimes that only just comes in the really tall jar.
Uh-huh.
You can use apricot nectar or
right.
orange juice as well, freshly squeezed orange juice.
Okay.
Now, this is quite a heavy batter at this stage.
I was just about to say that.
Yeah, don't be concerned that it's it is heavy, because you get all the moisture from the peaches, and that will lighten the cake up while it's cooking.
Do you know, my friends go to the country and eat a lot of peaches at my place. Because
right.
my peach trees have just been so wonderful
this year.
Heaps.
They have been beautiful. So it's a good time of year to be making cakes and things like this.
And Phil likes the white peaches.
Oh, my mum likes the white peaches as
well. Maybe Phil's your mum. Who knows?
No. I'm a big fan of the yellow peaches.
Yes.
And the clingstone is much better. So you can see how heavy that batter really is.
Yeah, it's scary.
It is, isn't it? It is a little bit of a worry, but that is quite normal.
Oh, and you spread that out.
Just spread all this out.
Okay, now your zapparoni back in there for how long?
This goes back into the microwave oven for about 12 minutes on medium power.
Medium power,
which is
12 minutes?
500 watts.
Do you let it sit there?
You must let it stand. It will still be a bit sticky when it comes out of the microwave oven.
Yeah, turn it out.
Let it stand.
Spatula it out.
That's
and
right.
There it is. And it smells fantastic. Dollop of cream. Upside down peach and hazelnut cake. Thank you, Janelle.
My pleasure. Serve it warm.
Warm.
If you'd like to receive any of the recipes from What's Cooking, phone 1900 185 015. Or if you'd like them faxed to you, phone 1900 185 010.
On A Current Affair.
Is your marriage making you miserable?
There are a lot of extra pressures.
Well, you can turn it all around.
Please congratulate them, everyone.
We couldn't be without one another.
Those who've made it work show you how.
No one's the boss.
Tonight, 6:30.
Hmm? To survive in the bush for days on end, you've got to know where to find the best tucker. I'm off to find my favourite. Not only is it delicious, but once you've picked it, it stays fresh for days. You don't even have to be an expert to root it out. And the best bit is, you can get it all year round. Sunblessed. It's the best thing since... Well, sliced bread.
Is your phone bill a shocker? Now you can tear up to 40% off overseas calls with GlobeTalk. Up to 40%. Simply direct dial the world with GlobeTalk's 1466 prefix. No fees, no minimum calls, no quality reduction. But you must have registered access. Call 1-800-500-234 now and start saving tomorrow. We're waiting to take your call on 1-800-500-234 now.
Introducing new Bird's Eye... Introducing new Bird's Eye Crunchy Potato Fish... Introducing new Bird's Eye Crunchy Potato Fish Fillets. Delicious white flaky fish fillets inside, crunchy potato crumbs outside.
Go on, Mum.
Where can you buy a magnificent high-back full-leather lounge suite with a choice of 15 colours and two recliners for just $28.99? Or this stunning full-leather suite with the same choice of colours for a sensational $17.99? Where else but John Coutts Furniture, Merrylands and Penrith?
It's March magic at Retrovision. Check out our latest catalogue. Retrovision has cooked up great deals on big-name white goods at Australia's biggest retailer of electrical appliances. Kelvinator, Simpson, Samsung, Sharp, Chef, Dishlex and Westinghouse. Don't just stand there, get into March magic.
On Burnt Backyard, how to add those vibrant 90s colours to your garden. A look at the success of three makeovers a year on. Plus, inner city living with the golden girl of athletics, Jane Fleming. Burnt Backyard, Friday, 7:30 on 9.
Last week, we spent a lot of time talking about different varieties of fish and their uses. Tomorrow, we'll continue that chat. We'll have a look at the same fish, well, maybe a fresh batch, and we'll show you the fillets and how they perform under pressure, under heat. Then we'll go on to make the classic fish and chip recipe. A lot of our recipes, we were chatting about this earlier, a lot of our recipes are creative and sort of bring in a lot of different elements. But the classic fish and chip recipe, this will be the simplest batter, but we'll talk about how you can improve it, how you can modify it, up to you. But we'll give you the basis from which to make great fish and chips. And also, Kerri-Ann Kennelly will be in. She'll be doing what is supposed to be an impossible chocolate pie, but if anyone can do it, she can do it. See you tomorrow.
8:30 tomorrow night, Ray Martin goes one-on-one with some of Hollywood's hottest stars, including Tom Cruise, George Lucas, and Ben Elton. Now you're talking with Ray Martin premieres 8:30 tomorrow night. Coming up, Entertainment Tonight. This program proudly brought to you by Spam, real spiced ham. A mad bomber has the rats running ragged.
He said next time it'll be a real bomb.
A deadly undercover operation.
I want 25,000 in this bill.
And guess who's in the firing line?
He's made contact.
Water Rats, Monday on 9. Tonight following...